Let's pray. Lord, we do look forward to what God, you're going to show us tonight. And great section here in Isaiah, kind of like almost, well, not quite the middle, but sort of the middle of the book. And God, what a ray of light. And I pray that as we work through these two chapters and look at what Isaiah is sharing with the people of Israel and Judah, and God, the light that he's given them, I pray that it would speak to our hearts. God, that it would encourage us and strengthen us. And that, Lord, I know we're coming from a whole bunch of different places. And God, some of us are doing well. Some of us are hurting. And some of us are hurting physically and some emotionally, God. And I just pray, God, you would speak to those situations in our life. And God, we would learn from, especially this section here in Isaiah, that we can trust our God no matter what. Even as we sang here in the beginning, God, no matter what, when we're down in the valley, when the waters rise, God, and sometimes when it looks so hopeless, God, we know that you are still faithful. So I do pray that, again, just open up our hearts to receive from you. And we pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Hey, if you remember, we're kind of, you know, in Isaiah's a lot of kind of bummer stuff, right? You read it and there's judgment and things coming down. And hopefully as we've kind of put it together with the Kings, it doesn't seem so much a bummer because we've been to understand why the judgment is coming. But I would think that if you're a person hanging out in Israel and Judah at that time, more particularly Judah, you're probably kind of tired of hearing it. You're kind of like, dude, lighten up, right? It's like, come on, man. It's doom and gloom. And even though some of the doom and gloom is for the nations around you that are hassling you, it's still doom and gloom. Well, this section here, man, Isaiah gives them, to me, bright, bright light and hope. And you know, here's the thing, though. He's challenging them, and it's going to be a challenge to us to walk by faith. You see, that's the hard part. And a lot of us, we want to walk by sight, and a lot of us do, if we're really honest, walk by sight. When things are going well, we're praising God, we're happy, we're thanking him, we're, woo-woo, God, you're on my side. When things are not going so well, we think he's deserted us, we think he's forgotten us, we think he's angry at us, which is not true. And we need to be people who, we trust our God in the good times, we trust our God in the bad times. Just like, again, that song that we sang, no matter what's going on, we got to trust him. So that's what Isaiah is sharing with them. So he's going to share with them some good times. In verse 1 of chapter 26, it says, in that day this song will be sung in the land of Judah. Remember, that day is speaking of the end, when we come to the, not the end, you know, for these guys, the end of the world is what he's talking about. And in that day, listen, when God comes for his people and redeems the nation of Israel, man, it's going to be a celebration like no other celebration ever. So listen, in that day, he says, this song will be sung in the land of Judah. We have a strong city. God will appoint salvation for walls and bulwarks. Open the gates that the righteous nation which keeps the truth may enter in. You will keep him in perfect peace whose mind is stayed on you because he trusts in you. Trust in the Lord forever, for Yah, the Lord, is everlasting strength, for he brings down those who will dwell on high. The lofty city he lays low. He lays it low to the ground. He brings it down to the dust. The foot shall tread it down, the feet of the poor and the steps of the needy. So as he begins this, listen, as he begins this, I believe he's talking about, I think the strong city could be any city, but I think more particular Jerusalem. He's talking about Jerusalem, but I love the idea. Listen, God's going to appoint salvation for its walls and its bulwarks. Listen, salvation is the thing that's going to protect them, not some physical barrier. But it's salvation in the Lord and the fact that the Lord is there. And then, listen, as the gates open, the righteous come in. But here's the verse I think is important for us to think about. I know it was for them. I know it is for us. You will keep him in perfect peace whose mind is stayed on you because he trusts in you. Man, in our generation, just peace is hard to find, much less perfect peace. And it's interesting, this could even be translated, you will keep him in peace. You know, there's peace, but then there's peace. There's like peace beyond understanding. Sounds like Philippians, doesn't it? And here's what he's saying. God will keep the one in perfect peace whose mind is stayed on him. In other words, even in our dark times, even in our hard times, even in our difficult times, even in the times where we can't even figure out if God is even close to us, we gotta keep our mind stayed on him, focused on him. And we are a generation of pill poppers, aren't we? Sorry, but I think we are. You know, I know some people need medication, but we're a generation and we're a culture where we don't want to feel any pain, whether it's physical pain or emotional pain, or, you know, we're just in that time. And sometimes pain can be good because pain can do things, certain things. And this microphone's messing up and I don't know why. In and out. I'm just going to throw it away. So anyway, sorry. Something's going through my head. Now I'm messed up. But yeah. But you know, we are those kind of people who we think that we should not experience any pain. And here's what he's letting Israel know. And we're going to find out. They're going to go through a lot. Listen, this is light, but there's some tough stuff in here. But verse 3 is the foundation for them to stay in that peace, in that perfect peace. And why? Because they're focused on God. And if you're focused on God, the rest of the world kind of comes in to me, that focus, and comes into that. So he tells us that. Then he talks about the strength of the Lord. And then verses 5 and 6, he's talking about God bringing down those who are haughty. And God is going to take care of them. You know what I found in my life is when I trust the Lord and I get focused on him, I'm not so worried about what others are doing to me or even what some big brother might do to me or whatever. It's not so important. Why? Because I'm looking at him and trusting him. And I need to know, listen, I've read the end of the book. I know who wins. And whenever I do that, man, when I get in those places, I keep going back to the end of the book. And, you know, maybe that's what some of us need. Read the end of the book and you'll know the end. And so he's saying, listen, they're going to be stomped down. Even the poor is going to walk on them. So, listen, how does all that take place? Or when does all that take place? Look at verse 7. He says, the way of the just is uprightness, O most upright. You weigh the path of the just, yes, the way of your judgments, O Lord, we have waited for you. The desire of our soul is for your name and for the remembrance of you. Listen how he's talking about. Listen, you can't have peace without righteousness, true peace. And it is interesting when you think about that, how, as one author put it that I was reading, how that righteousness and peace married together on the cross when Jesus came and Jesus died for our sins. So he's talking about this righteousness, you know, the coming. And then he says this verse 8, he says again, yes, in the way of your judgments, O Lord, we have waited for you. The desire of our soul is for your name and remembrance of you. With my soul, I have desired you in the night. Yes, by my spirit within me, I seek you early. For when your judgments are in the earth, the inhabitants of the world will learn righteousness. So here's what I love about Isaiah talking to the people. And he's telling the people, number one, keep your mind focused on God. That's where you find peace. But then number two, did you notice here in this section, he talks about that you desire God when you're going to bed, and you desire God when you're getting up. You have that just that desire to be with him. I think that's a good way to judge where we are at spiritually. Hey, when you're laying your head down, are you thinking about God? Are you thanking him for the day, thanking him for what's happening, kind of focused on him? I often pray right before I go to sleep that God would just give me some really cool dreams, you know, because I don't like bad dreams. So, and I want to dream about him. And then when you get up in the morning, what's the first thing you do? You know, hopefully, you know, some like brush your teeth or something. But are you focused on him? Do you start your day with him? And again, that doesn't mean, listen, I remember when I was first saved, people told me, if you're not up like at, you know, 4:30, 5 o'clock in the morning seeking the Lord, you're just not spiritual. And some of you are going, dude, that is never going to happen. I don't think the Bible gives us a time when we're supposed to wake up. And I don't think more spiritual people are up early and the less spiritual sleep in. You know, that's a little bit bogus and laying trips on people. But are we giving him the first part of our day? And listen, that doesn't mean always 1 hour. I've got that trip laid on me. Man, if you don't spend an hour with God every morning, you're doing something wrong. Some of us, we only need like 10 minutes to say our prayer. We don't have a lot to pray about. Come before God, talk to him. Hey, and when you're done talking, just leave, right? No one likes rambling. Have you ever been around that person? Just stop. God doesn't appreciate it either. You might want to listen, but listen, just do your time. And even if you have, even if you can just say, God, I really want you to bless my day today. Do that. Start there and begin to think of him. But listen, you're not going to find that peace. You're not going to find, you know, that safety if you're not focusing on him and dwelling on him and have that desire at night, the desire in the morning. And then he talks about the judgments coming and the inhabitants of the world learning righteousness. Then, listen to 10 and 11. He says, let grace be shown to the wicked, yet he will not learn righteousness. In the land of uprightness, he will deal unjustly and will not behold the majesty of the Lord. Lord, when your hand is lifted up, they will not see, but they will see and be ashamed for their envy of people. Yes, the fire of your enemies shall devour them. Here's what Isaiah is trying to say. There are some people who are committed to being blind spiritually. They're not going to see no matter what you do. And I think a lot of us have run into those people, right? You try and share with them, and they just push back and push back, and no matter what. And he says, listen, there are some wicked people. It doesn't matter what you do. They're determined to be blind, and they're going to be blind. And then it's interesting, though, he does say, in that day of judgment, they're going to be envious. I remember years ago, I went to a concert down in Douglas, a Christian concert down in Douglas, and a Christian heavy metal band was playing. Not my style of music. And I remember walking up, and it was kind of rowdy and loud, and I thought, well, this is a little strange, you know, and listening a little bit as much as I could, and I couldn't quite figure out what was going on. But I remember a guy came up to me and gave me a track, and handed me a track, and I took it, and here's what the headline of the track was. There are no unbelievers in hell. And I thought, well, that's kind of, what kind of Christian concert is this? And what are they doing? And then I opened it up, and it said, 30 seconds in hell will make you a believer. But it's too late. Oh, that kind of hit me, you know, that was pretty heavy. And then I go, well, man, this heavy metal band's pretty good. These guys are all right. But you see, Isaiah's saying, they're going to be envious, they're going to be jealous, they're going to be looking at that, but it's too late. And I hope that reading something like that gives us compassion for people around us who don't know Jesus. You see, and we would want to bring them in. I want the whole world saved. I don't know about you guys. I'm not a universalist. I'm thinking they're all gonna, you know, just, but man, don't you want everybody to should be, I don't know what's wrong with this microphone. Maybe it's there. I'll stay over here. So, I think it's Rob's stuff. Can I turn this stuff off? No, I can't. So listen, Isaiah lays that out. Now he's going to go back and talk about what God is going to do for the nation. Verse 12, Lord, you will establish peace for us, for you have also done all our works in us. O Lord, our God, masters beside you have had dominion over us, but by you only we make mention of your name. They are dead and they will not live. They are deceased, they will not rise. Therefore you have punished and destroyed them and made all their memory perish. You have increased the nation, O Lord, and you have increased the nation. You are glorified. You have expanded all the borders of the land. Listen, Isaiah's talking like he's there, isn't it? Aren't you kind of reading this thinking, well, he's talking about current. No, he's talking about way in the future. But he sees it as now, as he's talking about way in the future. And here's what he's saying. The people of Israel realize something, that number one, God is the one that establishes them. God is the one that brings them peace. And all of the rulers, when we talk about all of the people who have ruled over Israel, up to Isaiah's time and then afterwards. Think of what all the world has done to Israel. Kind of crazy, isn't it? And here's what he's saying. It doesn't matter because God is their master. Oh, they've had other masters, but God is the one who protects them, takes care of them, and God is going to increase that nation. You know, whenever I think about things and, you know, countries and stuff coming against Israel, I always think, you know what? Doesn't matter what countries do. Doesn't even matter what the UN does. You know what? God is in control. And ultimately, that little slice of the world is where God claimed for himself. And it doesn't really belong to Israel. It belongs to God. He's going to take care of it. It's his. And it is interesting how, you know, everything's focused there. Isn't it interesting, of all of the Middle East, the one country that has no oil, nothing really to give anybody, is the one everybody's fighting about. Kind of interesting. So listen, he says, that's going to go. God is going to increase the nation. And then, listen, verse 16, Lord, in trouble, they have visited you. Talking about people coming to the Lord once he is punishing them. They poured out prayer when your chastening was upon them, as a woman with child is in pain when she cries in her pangs, when she draws near in the time of her delivery, so have we been in your sight, O Lord. We have been with child and have been in pain, and we have, as it were, brought forth wind. We have not accomplished any deliverance in the earth, nor have the inhabitants of the world fallen. Here's what we're looking at. We're looking at Revelation here. We're looking at that time of tribulation when Israel's really going to go through the ringer before they accept the Lord. They've got to go through a time of tribulation. They've got to go through a time of pain. And Isaiah's talking about that. And it's interesting, the only time he's saying Israel calls out to God is when they're hurting. How about us? That kind of stings. When I read that stuff, maybe you guys are better. When I read that stuff, it kind of stings me, because here's what I realize. I get really serious with the Lord when I'm in pain. And I'm not just talking about physical. I'm talking about emotional things going on. And I got to be really honest, man. I think I'm like most people. When things are going really well, oftentimes I'm not as serious. And that's where we need people around us. Not necessarily to hold us accountable, but people around us to encourage us. And people around us even sometimes to maybe even convict us a little. We look at them and go, man, they're reading their Bible. Why ain't I reading my Bible? Man, they're seeking the Lord. Why am I not seeking the Lord? What's the matter with me? So listen, he's saying, man, when it gets hard, you know, it's tough on them. And then I love verse 19. Listen, verse 19, he says, your dead shall live, together with my dead body they shall rise. Isn't it interesting? Here's what I'm thinking, man. Isaiah's looking, obviously, at the resurrection. But here's what I like. Isaiah's saying he's going to rise, right? I've heard people say you should never, never tell people you're saved and you're going to heaven, because you can't know. That's bad theology. I know I'm going to heaven. I am perfectly confident. It's not because I'm a good guy. It's because I got a great God. And that's what I love it, man. I love Isaiah. I think this would be a great tattoo. Together with my dead body they shall rise. That's just like good, huh? Someone do that. Show it to me. Doesn't that just sound good? Together with my dead body they shall rise. Awake and sing, you who dwell in the dust, for your dew is like the dew of herbs, And the earth shall cast out the dead. Isn't that a great way to talk about the resurrection? It's like the earth is going, get out of here, right? Now, here's what's interesting. I was reading today and looking at this, talking about the resurrection. And, you know, oftentimes we think like, you know, God's got to put us all back together in order to resurrect our physical body. There might be some truth to that, but I think he only needs just a scrap of the DNA. Because remember, we're getting new bodies. He's not going to restore this thing, praise God. He's not going to like look at that and go, wow, I can do something with it, you know. No, we're getting new bodies. So you know, I'm not so sure. And, you know, for years, churches would say you shouldn't be cremated. You have to be buried because if you're cremated, how's God going to put you back together again? And every time I hear that argument, I think that's a little foolish. Because people who die, they rot. Just saying. You rot. You go dig up somebody who's been in the ground 30, 40 years, you're going to find out. They just turned to dust. So God can put you back together. Now, he's calling the people. Verse 20, come, my people, enter your chambers, shut your doors behind you, hide yourself as it were for a little moment until the indignation is past. You kind of getting the idea this might be the time where God takes them away? For behold, the Lord comes out of his place to punish the inhabitants of the earth for their iniquity. The earth will also disclose her blood and will no more cover her slain. So listen, again, he's looking at that, you know, just kind of in a couple verses, gives us that whole tribulation period. And then he says this, verse 1 of 27, I think might belong with 26. He says, in that day, the Lord with his severe sword and great and strong will punish Leviathan, the fleeing serpent, Leviathan, that twisted serpent, and he will slay the reptile that is in the sea. Now, I read that. I got to be really honest. You read that and go, I don't get it. Who's Leviathan? And it's, you know, it is interesting. Some people who want to, like, try and help God out, like, they make up the weirdest things. Like, they say Leviathan's a hippopotamus. If you read the description of Leviathan in Job, he ain't no hippopotamus. He's got a big old honking tail. Have you ever seen a hippopotamus's tail? Check it out. Go on Google, not while I'm teaching. Check it out. Listen, this was, and in some ways, I think Leviathan was almost a mythological character. Maybe they were describing, I think, a dinosaur in Job's day, some kind of creature. A lot of people say it was mythological. Why would Isaiah use a mythological creature when he's talking? And listen, I don't think he's talking about God literally coming down and, you know, slicing up a dinosaur. I mean, I read that, and I mean, if you take it literally, that's kind of what people are trying to say. He's going to come down, he's going to slice this thing up with a sword. You notice he says three different things. He says he's going to punish Leviathan, the fleeing serpent, Leviathan, that twisted serpent, and then he will slay the reptile that is in the sea. It's kind of interesting. He kind of gives those three different descriptions of what is going on. So I kind of think he might be talking, he could be referring maybe Leviathan as a symbol of the satanic attack coming against Israel. You know, the serpent, right? We know that. And he might be talking about, you know, the three major countries that have come against Israel up to this time. Assyria, Babylon, and Egypt. And some people say, well, you see that Assyria is this fleeing serpent because of what Assyria does, Leviathan, the twisted serpent. Well, obviously that's Babylon because it's around, you know, this river, and then the reptile that is in the sea has to be Egypt because it's down by the Red Sea. I'm not so sure, but I think he's talking something like that. In other words, here's what he's saying. There's nothing going to come against Israel that's going to stand. Why? Because God is going to protect them, not because Israel's great. You know, I love it when we go to Israel. I love to visit Israel, but I do get a little bit tired when I hear Israel thinking they're all that. You know, right now, Israel's pretty secular. You got to understand that. You know, the Jews that are there are not there following God. They're there because they want to be in their homeland, etc., the majority. and they're not spiritual people. So they think they've done really good. You talk to a Jew and, man, listen, we drain the swamps. Not like Trump's, but they drain. That just popped in my head, sorry. They drain the swamps, they planted stuff, they're the, you know, heavy produce growers of the whole region, and they export and they do all that. And you'll hear them say, we figured that out. And I always remind them, no, God figured that out for you. God is making you strong. God is giving you favor. And if you forget God, you know, he might just deport you again, right? He might just kick you out of this country. Listen, we think that it's settled, that this is the end, and all of us look for Jesus coming back. We don't know that God is going to deport them out of there again and regather them again. He's done it several times, so it wouldn't be beyond him. So listen, here's what he's saying. He's saying, we're going to take care of the countries around you. Then here's what they're singing. Again, in that day, sing to her, in verse 2, a vineyard of red wine. I, the Lord, keep it. I water it every moment, lest any hurt it. I keep it night and day. Hey, are you picking up? Do you remember, you guys who have been studying with us? Remember chapter 5 of Isaiah? He talks about a vineyard, kind of the same thing. But in chapter 5, he talks about a vineyard that he grows and protects and takes care of, and the vineyard kind of rejects him. Now, listen, this is God taking care of his people. Isaiah's wanting to get across to the people of Israel in his generation, God's not mad at you. Sounds like a song, huh? God's not angry with you. God is not coming at you as someone who is in a rage and wants to get you. Here's what he wants them to understand. God loves you. God wants to protect you. God wants to take care of you. God wants to comfort you. God wants to protect you. And you know what? Maybe we need to hear that. God's not angry with us. He's wanting to take care of us. He's wanting to protect us. So listen, now he's that vineyard, and check this out. He says again at the end of verse 3, I keep it night and day, verse 4. Fury is not in me. You get that? Fury is not in me. God's not angry. He's not mad. He's not torqued off. You see, I think sometimes we relate, you know, maybe our fathers, our physical fathers, maybe they, you know, I don't know about you guys, but I did hear occasionally in my life, that's it. I've had it. Any of you ever hear that? And then you heard the infamous belt loops. I love, Pastor Jack said if he takes his belt off too fast, he breaks into a sweat even to this day because of that. Then you hear that belt coming. Ay, ay, ay. And so listen, some of us relate that. You know, we relate that same thing. Listen, our fathers were human, and they had limitations. God is not in heaven going, that's it, I've had it. No. I love the beginning of that verse, man. Listen, fury is not in me. It's not in God. And he says, who would set briars and thorns against me in battle? I would go through them, and I would burn them together. Or let him take hold of my strength, that he may make peace with me, and he shall make peace with me. Those who come, he shall cause to take root in Jacob. Israel shall blossom and bud and fill the face of the world with fruit. He has struck Israel as he had struck those who struck him. Has he struck Israel as those who struck him? Or has he been slain according to the slaughter of those who were slain by him? In other words, he's saying, look at the countries around. God's not going to do to you, Israel, what he did to those countries, right? They deserve judgment. God brought judgment. That's not for you. In measure, in verse 8, in measure, by sending it away, you contended with it. He removed it by his rough wind in the day of the east wind. Therefore, the iniquity of Jacob will be covered. And this is all the fruit of taking away his sin, when he makes all the stones of the altar like chalk stones that are beaten to dust, wooden images and incense altars, he shall not stand. Listen to what he's saying. You guys are rejecting me. I'm not rejecting you, but I am going to discipline you. I got to bring some discipline because you've been disobedient, right? And he talks about destroying the idols that they brought up. Yet, verse 10, and yet the fortified city will be desolate. Maybe again talking about Jerusalem when he's going to come in, he's going to take them out. They're going to leave the city, right? They don't think so, but God is going to take them out. The inhabitants are forsaken, left like a wilderness. There the calf will feed, and there it will lie down and consume its branches. When its boughs are withered, they will be broken off. The women come and set them on fire, for it is a people of no understanding. Therefore, he who makes them will not have mercy on them, and he who formed them will show them no favor. So again, God's judgment is coming, not against Israel, against those around Israel. Now, here's the culmination of everything. Verse 12, and it shall come to pass in that day that the Lord will thresh, and from the channel of the river to the brook of Egypt, and you will be gathered one by one, O you children of Israel. So it shall be in that day, the great trumpet will be blown, and they will come who are about to perish in the land of Assyria, and those who are outcast in the land of Egypt, and they shall worship the Lord in the holy mountain at Jerusalem. Israel, God has not forgotten you. Now again, it's interesting because they haven't even, listen, the northern tribes haven't even been, you know, taken yet. And surely the southern tribes, Judah and Benjamin, they're thinking they're totally safe. Yet Isaiah is letting them know there's going to come a day and it's all going to come undone. Yet, listen what he says, God has not forsaken you, even when it feels like it. Could you imagine being a Jew when the Babylonians came in? Remember what they told Jeremiah? Jeremiah said, you guys, you need to make a deal or something, man. This is not going to work out. This is not going to be good for you. Jeremiah, we hate you. We're going to throw you in a pit. Because you need to understand something. This is God's temple. This is God's city, and he will never allow anybody to come and get us. Yeah, he did. He did. He did it again in 70 AD after they rejected Jesus. God's not beyond scolding his children, just like our physical fathers. Hopefully our fathers were, you know, good disciplinarians, not overboard or whatever. And, you know, I shared with you, my dad never spanked any of the neighbor kids. Spanked me. Never brought the neighbor kids in and spanked them. Why? Because he cared about me. I mean, I think he cared about them, but he really loved me. He wanted to fix me. So listen, that's God. And God is taking Israel, and here's what he's letting them know. When you're in that place, listen carefully, when you're far away in Babylon, doesn't mean I don't love you. Doesn't even mean I don't want to protect you. Doesn't mean I don't want to care for you. What it means is you're stupid, and just to put it blunt. You're not obeying me, and here's the deal. I will bring you back because I care about you. And I read these two chapters, man, and here's what I'm thinking, man. Israel has heard a whole bunch of stuff, and they've heard about everything going on, and then all of a sudden God says, you know what, I really love you guys, and I'm going to take care of you guys. Wow, that's a little refreshing. I think we might even take these two chapters and not even look so much way in the future. Maybe we could look at our own selves and understand that Jesus died on the cross because he loves us. And he died on the cross to give us eternal life. And he's reaching out. We sing it in a song. His arms are open wide. He wants us to come to him. And so tonight we're coming to the table, we're celebrating the fact that Jesus Christ chose to die for our sins. How great is that? Whenever I think about that, I get overwhelmed because my God is that great. And so reading this chapter, yeah, these two chapters, yeah, I kind of see the whole thing with Israel, but I see a bigger picture, and it has to do with Jesus Christ coming and dying on the cross for the sin of the world. of the whole world, not just Israel, of the whole world. And anyone who wants to be saved can be saved. There are going to be those who choose blindness no matter what, but anyone who wants it, God has never turned anyone away. Let's stand up and pray. Father, we thank you, Lord, as we look at this, and God, just as we think about your love for us and your care for us, and Lord, it is pretty amazing that you would leave heaven and come to earth. That in and of itself is almost beyond comprehension. And then, God, that you would yourself take our sin and take the punishment, the consequences that we have earned because of our sin, and take it upon yourself so that we could be set free. God, that is good news. And Lord, we thank you. And we thank you that we can come to you and we can find that safety. And I thank you that, Lord, we can walk by faith, setting our mind upon you, fixing our hearts towards you. And then we will have that thing that you call peace, peace, perfect peace. And we pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen.